to my gospel. 2:9, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. 2:10, therefore I endure all things for the elect's sakes, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. 2:11, it is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. 2:12, if we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. 2:13, if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. 2:14, of these things put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord, that they strive not about words, to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. 2:15, study to shew thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. 2:16, but shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. 2:17, and their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Photius. 2:18, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. 2:19, nevertheless the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. 2:20, but in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor.
Living waters flow on, sweep away my pain, bring your healing to my heart, help me love once again. Cares and worries get me down, fear of failure fills my day. When I'm lost and all alone, help me, Lord, to find a way. People knocking at my door, strangers seeking love and care. Never let me turn them down. Teach me gently how to share. Children come into my life with their laughter and their song. When will I become like them? Lord, to sing along. Living waters flow on, sweep away my pain, bring your healing to my heart, help me love once again.
There is love.
have sex for all eternity long. And fight, there is no like you. There is no like you.
There is no like you.
No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
There is none like you.
I could search for all eternity long. There is none.
There is none.
There is none. Flow on, sweep away my pain, bring your healing to my heart, help me love once again. Cares and worries get me down, fear of failure fills my day. When I'm lost and all alone, help me, Lord, to find a way. People knocking at my door, strangers seeking love and care. Never let me turn them down. Teach me gently how to share. Children come into my life with their laughter and their song. When will I become like them? Lord, to sing along. Living waters flow on, sweep away my pain, bring your healing to my heart, help me love once again.
Luke 1:9-17, and he said unto him, Well, thou good servant, hold on, God knows what he is doing. Luke 1:9-11, and as they heard these things, he added and spake a parable, because he was nigh to Jerusalem, and because they thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. Luke 1:9-12, he said therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom, and to return. Acts 1:6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? Acts 1:7. And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. Acts 1:8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Acts 1:9. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. The Acts 1:10. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. The Acts 1:1:1. Which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Luke 1:9:1-2. He said, Therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. John 1:1-5. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. John 1:1-6. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? Luke 1:9:3. And he called his 10 servants, and delivered them 10 pounds, and said unto them, Occupy till I come. Ephesians 6:1:1. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. God's perfect justice demands payment for sin. Job 2:2-3. If thou return to the Almighty, thou shalt be built up, thou shalt put away iniquity far from thy tabernacles. Romans 5:1. Therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Job 3:3-4. For God speaketh once, yea twice, yet man perceiveth it not. Job 3:3-5. In a dream, in a vision of the night, when deep sleep falleth upon men, in sunburns upon the bed. Romans 5:1. Therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Job 3:3-6. Then he openeth the ears of men, and sealeth their instruction. Romans 5:1. Therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Job 3:3-7. That he may withdraw man from his purpose, and hide pride from man. Job 3:3-8. He keepeth back his soul from the pit, and his life from perishing by the sword. Romans 8:1-8. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Job 3:3-9. He is chastened also with pain upon his bed, and the multitude of his bones with strong pain. Job 3:3-0. So that his life abhorreth bread, and his soul dainty meat. Job 3:3-1. His flesh is consumed away, that it cannot be seen, and his bones that were not seen stick out. Job 3:3-2. Yea, his soul draweth near unto the grave, and his life to the destroyers. John 8:1-2. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. John 8:1-3. The Pharisees therefore said unto him, Thou bearest record of thyself, thy record is not true. John 8:1-4. Jesus answered and said unto them, Though I bear record of myself, yet my record is true. For I know whence I came, and whither I go, but ye cannot tell whence I come, and whither I go. John 8:1-5. Ye judge after the flesh, I judge no man. John 8:1-6. And yet if I judge, my judgment is true. For I am not alone, but I and the Father that sent me. John 8:1-7. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Galatians 6:9. And let us not be weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. Matthew 4:1. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Matthew 4:2. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward an hungered. Matthew 4:3. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Matthew 4:4. But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Matthew 4:5. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, Matthew 4:6, and saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Matthew 4:7. Jesus said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Ephesians 6:1-1. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Matthew 4:8. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them. Matthew 4:9. And saith unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Matthew 4:10. Then saith Jesus unto him, Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Matthew 4:1-1. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. John 8:3-2. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. John 3:1-6. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Acts 4:1-2. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. Proverbs 1:7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Is it right to believe in apparitions appearing in heaven claiming to be Mother Mary? Are we worshipping image of Satan? Be not deceived. God is not mocked. All sin carries with it the punishment of eternal death, as we see from John 1:14-15. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. The child of God fully comprehends the ominous warning of Gal 6:7, Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Everything in the Scriptures shows us that God is not to be trifled with or lightly esteemed, as we understand from a passage like Matt 10:28, And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him (God) which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. The judgment of God against sin is second death, eternal damnation in hell. Remember Hebrews 10:31 admonishes, It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. By nature none of us have this fear of God, as we have previously learned from other verses, such as Esau 29:13. Wherefore the Lord said, For as much as this people draw near me with their mouth, and with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men. This is a similar statement to what we find in Matt 1:5-9, where the Lord Jesus declares, But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Genuine fear of God, like genuine worship of God, must be done according to God's word in spirit and in truth. The Bible is replete with examples that warn of us of this fact. Consider the testimony of him who, as the judge of all the earth, is soon to appear to both try and condemn all who have not been clothed with his glorious righteousness. Deut 10:17 declares God as the supremely righteous ruler and highlights God's perfect holiness in meting out his justice and righteousness. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, a great God, a mighty and a terrible, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. The Lord Jesus Christ is King of kings and Lord of lords, and the rod of iron in Rev 19:15-16 indicates his judgment upon the unsaved of the world. It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Isaiah 4:2-2, I have blotted out, as a thick cloud, thy transgressions, and as a cloud, thy sins. Return unto me, for I have redeemed thee. I Peter 5:6, Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. I Peter 5:7, Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. I Peter 5:8, Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. I Peter 5:9, Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Job 2:2-3, If thou return to the Almighty, thou shalt be built up, thou shalt put away iniquity far from thy tabernacles. Job 2:2-4, Then shalt thou lay up gold as dust, and the gold of Ophir as the stones of the brooks. Job 2:2-5, Yea, the Almighty shall be thy defense, and thou shalt have plenty of silver. Matthew 6:1-9, Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Matthew 6:2-0, But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. Matthew 6:2-1, For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Job 2:2-4, Then shalt thou lay up gold as dust, and the gold of Ophir as the stones of the brooks. Job 2:2-5, Yea, the Almighty shall be thy defense, and thou shalt have plenty of silver. When you have a good heart, you help too much, you trust too much, you love too much, and it always seems like you are the one who gets hurt the most. Mark 1:2-9, And Jesus answered him, The first of all the commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Mark 1:2-3-0, And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. Mark 1:2-3-1, And the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. Mark 1:2-3-2, And the scribe said unto him, Well, Master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but he.
Marching in the love of God, we are marching in the love of God, we are marching in the love of God, we are marching, oh, we are marching, oh, we are marching in the love of God, we are marching, oh, we are marching, oh, we are marching in the love of God, we are living in the love of God, we are living in the love of God. We are living in the love of God. We are living in the love of God. We are living, oh, we are living, oh, we are living in the love of God. We are living, oh, we are living, oh, we are living in the love of God. are dancing in the love of God. We are dancing in the love of God. We are dancing in the love of God. We are dancing, oh, we are dancing, oh, we are dancing in the love of God. We are dancing, oh, we are dancing, oh, we are dancing in the love of God. He's given Jesus Christ His Son.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ.
Today shalt thou be with me in paradise, 3rd June. No mercy without judgment were read in 1 Cor 15:56 that the sting of death is sin, and in Romans 6:23 the wages of sin is death. In this verse, as well as many others in the Bible, we notice that God is linking death to sin. Because of this fact, we know that God is not referring to physical death, but to spiritual death, which is ultimately the eternal second death, or hell. John 1:15 also expresses the same idea, as it pinpoints the origin and progression of all sin. Then, when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. The reason this is so is because sin, by biblical definition, is the transgression of God's law, as stated in 1 John 3:4, an exceedingly relevant verse. Whosoever committeth sin, transgresseth also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. You and I are fully aware that, when we break one of the laws of our land, there will be consequences, and in the case of sin, the consequences are eternal in duration and intensity. Our sin is like an insurmountable debt of infinite proportions that can never be paid, as the parable in Matt 18:34 explains, and his Lord was wroth, and delivered him to the tormentors, till he should pay all that was due unto him. Everything in the scriptures shows us that God is not to be trifled with or lightly esteemed. It is no wonder that the Bible uses such horrific language as "vengeance is mine, I will repay," found in Rom 12:19, and Hebrews 10:31 warns, "It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." Eternal God is a God of law, and the Bible is his law book. God created the universe and established his physical, moral, and spiritual laws according to his infinite wisdom and sovereign will. He enforces his rules for his righteous purposes and for his glory according to his standards of perfect justice. Every sin we commit is a transgression of God's law, as we read in 1 John 3:4. Therefore, every sin is judged by God himself, in the person of Jesus Christ, as John 5:22 declares, "For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son." The wicked, in Psalm 9:17, are all those from all the nations of the world who are unsaved on judgment day. The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. Hell is terrible, and it exists because God created man to be accountable to God for his actions, because God's perfect justice demands payment for sin. However, before God will send anyone to hell, that person must be tried and found guilty of committing a crime. Sadly for us all, a guilty verdict is certain, as James 2:10 states, "For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all." Ultimately, God alone gives or takes away physical life. But what is infinitely more important is the state of our soul, according to Matt 10:28, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." Only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, Rev 21:27, will be spared the eternal anguish of hell, which is figuratively called the lake of fire in Rev 20:15, "And whosoever was not found written in the Book of Life was cast into the lake of fire." Remember that references to fire and smoke in the Bible are often used to symbolize the wrath of God. Consider the testimony of him who, as the judge of all the earth, is soon to appear to both try and condemn all who have not been clothed with his glorious righteousness, in the sobering words of Rev 19:11-21. Is God justified in his anger? The
far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The path of sin too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home.
There is forgiveness, so I go to God. I know that this is where I ought to be going, yet I am beginning to fear, especially as I am hearing that time is running out, and the day of judgment is right around the corner. It is almost like we are being pushed to the sea, like the Israelites in Moses' day. There they were at the sea, and the Egyptians were in hot pursuit. They needed a miracle. The sea had to part, and only God could do that. He alone can open up the sea, as He did historically. He alone can have mercy and save us. But we have to remember that God is saving a great multitude of people, and that all it takes to qualify is to be a sinner. This is a faithful saying, and worthy of all acceptance.